Let me see your identification.
The name's Bond. James Bond.
You must be Igor.
You've got a real attitude problem.
Danger's my middle name.
Wait, let me explain something to you.
I am an FBI agent!
I know, man, isn't it wild?
Well, my mistake!
Do you eat a lot of paint chips when you were a kid? Why?
Are you shook up? Are you nervous?
Supernatural, perhaps.
Christ, look at that. God help us.
You're gonna need a bigger potion.
Holy shit! Where's the Tylenol?
We'd like to get a sample of your brain tissue.
Okay.
Should I give him some medicine?
It's alive!
You know what's going on?
Welcome to Face the real podcast that inspires and changes lives. Working as a stuntman and stunt coordinator in the motion picture and television world for over 27 years, I had the pleasure to meet and work with some amazing people. Actors, producers, directors, wardrobe, hair and makeup, fellow stunt performers, you name it. Here you get to hear some unbelievable stories from awesome people and their journeys through their lives, their struggles, and how they got to where they are today. Some of them funny, some of them sad, but never boring, and hopefully will help you to reach your goals, whatever they might be. I am Oliver Keller, and I'm excited to have you with me to Face the Real,
Michelle Garbin.
Welcome, my dear friend Michelle Garbin on Face the Real. I'm so stoked to have you. It's been too long since I've seen you.
It has been a while. It's like, I can't wait for us all to go back to work.
Yeah, right. Same here. Are you going to be back on The Rookie with us?
I hope to eventually be over there, especially since it shoots for so long.
Yeah. Hey, and today we just got the package you sent. So thank you so much for this here. Look, got it.
Excellent. Yep. Right on.
Your personal skincare line, Vivid. I love it. And Geneva was so excited. It was very kind of you to have all those individual packages. It was very sweet of you. Thank you.
And if she has any questions, she can email me, she can call me, she can text me.
Yeah, absolutely. We'll talk more about your stuff in a bit. But, I can actually say for the first time, because, you know, this Face the Real is fairly young, I'm going to dedicate today's episode to Vivid skincare products.
Excellent. And today is National Lipstick Day.
Oh, is that right?
So it's like perfect because I collect lips, as you can see.
Yep. What are you, what kind of art are you doing? You paint?
Those are a little bit of acrylic. I hadn't touched acrylic in a couple decades, but when COVID hit and most of the studio work shut down, I was making my own acrylic at first, and I don't recommend it because I would go back to the fish like the next day or 2 days later, and I would see that all the colors separated. So then finally I got some real acrylics and started painting.
What do you mean you?
It's been great meditation, and it helps, I think, to relieve the stress.
Yeah, absolutely. What do you mean you made your own acrylic?
So I put like pigments and paint, like I tried to find it online, like a recipe, and I ended up, it didn't turn out that great. So I do recommend buying acrylics, and they're not that expensive. There was an art class from the paint lab in Santa Monica, and I was taking the class and I needed paint instantly. So I looked online and I found a recipe and I tried making one. So it's mostly pigment and food coloring.
Okay. Wow. Very cool.
a little acrylic glue.
Wow. I had no idea. Hey, tell us who you are and where you're from.
I'm Michelle Garbin. I'm a makeup artist and esthetician. I was born in Alameda, California, which is Northern California, and I grew up in a place called Pleasanton. And it's very Pleasantville-y, if you've seen the movie. And then I went to UC Santa Barbara, and from there I came to Los Angeles, and the rest has been history.
Wow. What was little Michelle like? As a kid,
I cannot sit still in school. That's for sure. And I'd always like to play with my friends' hair, makeup. The only class I really enjoyed in high school was anatomy. So we got to go to UC Berkeley on a field trip one time, and it was to study the cadavers. And I realized, I'm like, I really like this. And little did I know I was going to become a makeup artist and do special effects and then get to recreate that as in my adult life. Because I didn't, where I grew up, we didn't really have makeup artists. I didn't really know what a makeup artist was.
Was it that small of a place, or what do you mean? You weren't really.
Yeah, it was pretty small. We had a lot of. We were really close to Oakland and to San Francisco, so we had a lot of professional athletes that I grew up with. A lot of football players, baseball players, but nobody in Hollywood. So I didn't really. I knew what a makeup artist was. I knew what a stunt person was, but I didn't really know what it was like.
Mm-hmm. And so you mentioned you got the interest, you know, with hair and makeup at a very young age.
Yeah. I was thankful that I couldn't keep still in high school and that my teachers allowed me to go to cosmetology school. But I realized that hair was not my thing. Like when I would cut hair, I would almost like freak out and I'd be like, oh my gosh, it doesn't go back. And cutting hair is a completely different mindset. But I like the makeup because you could put the makeup on and if you didn't like it, you could take it off and start over. And I realized, like, I really like this.
And how did you make up your mind to approach that profession?
I guess my big break was at UC Santa Barbara. While I was going to school and I got an internship on Days of Our Lives in the art department. And when I graduated from UCSB, I became a page for NBC, and they had the studios used to have makeup and hair departments. So I ended up learning how to do makeup from them. And then I had a personal, her name was Lynn Redgrave, and we did a one woman show, and I would travel with her doing the one woman show. And I would do everything from her makeup to her hair to her wardrobe. And that was the start of it.
What kind of a one woman show was it?
It was called Shakespeare for My Father. And we would, we started in Los Angeles and then I went to Seattle with her and we went to Tucson, Arizona. So it was really cool. I got to do that for 2 years.
Wow. That sounds like a lot of fun. And you got to do wardrobe as well, you said.
Yeah, I pretty much did wardrobe for her, hair, makeup. It was an amazing experience and such a great lady. She passed away a couple of years ago, but I was so grateful that that was one of my first jobs to get to travel and work with such great people.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And you have to be versatile, right? So you were more than just a makeup lady, which it all helps in the experience, of course. And you were mentioning you started at a soap opera, right? At Days of Our Lives.
I did in the art department. I had an internship and I thought that was much better than, I like to keep doing that and getting credits for school as opposed to going to school itself.
Sure. And then from there, how did the ball get rolling?
Well, while I was working for Lynn, I started doing low budget movies. And then finally, I got hired on a bigger budget, which was Three Kings. It was like my first big movie.
Oh, wow.
I had no idea what I was doing. I was the third. And all of a sudden I went from one actress to 200, 300 background. And it was a war movie. And I learned a lot on that, I have to say. Found out what stunt people were and then to recreate stunt people to look like the main actors. And I really liked it. Working with dirt and blood and special effects, sweat. And it was fun.
That's stuff that a lot of people don't even think about. Like you mentioned sweat just now, right? All and dirt. And there's so much more to makeup than just applying the makeup, right? For, you know.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. There's continuity. And a lot of times movies don't shoot in order. So what happens on the first day in scene one, sometimes you're doing scene two 3 months later and you have to keep the beard continuity and the mustache continuity. And like if they got beat up in the first scene and by the end of the movie, it's 15 days later, you have to keep pictures of that. And we used to keep it on Polaroids, mm-hmm. but now a lot of times we're keeping it on our phone.
Yeah.
Although I had just had a client send me a camera. So I was like, oh, well, that's cool. So I think they're constantly finding a way to keep the continuity.
Yeah. I remember everywhere was Polaroids, right? And I don't know, I guess I'm an analog guy. I kind of like that, you know, physical aspect of it. I like to have pictures on hand. I like to read scripts on paper.
I do too, but with the COVID world, I just worked last week and I'm going to be working next week. They don't like paper. Like, paper is kind of taboo these days, especially with COVID going around.
Yeah, that's definitely a valid point, right? Wow. Okay. So, and then what about special effects makeup? You mentioned that. That's a whole different ball game, right? It's a whole.
It really is. Yeah.
How did you manage to get in there? Was that something that attracted you a lot, or were you more into the beauty makeup?
I definitely started off as beauty, and I did a lot of print in the beginning, mostly just straight basic makeup. And then I would see the special effects artists, and I always like, I really want to learn that. So I started taking, I never went to makeup school to learn how to do Hollywood makeup or motion pictures or television, but I would take private lessons and I would try to learn on set. And I would always watch people and I would start practicing. And to this day, I still practice all the time. Mm-hmm. I think it's really important to practice. I'm always taking classes. I love learning. I love honing my skills, and I think it helps me, like even painting, it helps me become a better artist.
Yeah, no, I definitely think you made a good point. And actually that was something Waldo was mentioning too the other day. He said, you have to continue to create, you have to continue to learn, you know, because no matter how good you are at your job, there's always something you can learn. There's always something you can do better and more efficient. And sometimes there's old ways that still work. I remember, I forgot the makeup gentleman I worked with on Star Trek, but he had to apply a beard, and it wasn't a one piece. Like, he made the whole thing, you know, with layers, right? And he wanted to bring some texture into it, make it a little fuller. And so he had this, I forgot what it's called, but it's an iron that you put in like a little heater oven. Then you take it out and you twist and, you know, twist the hairs. You know what I'm talking about?
They get really hot. It's an oven and it's, yeah. The Marcel irons is what they're called. Okay. And they're different sizes. And so was the beard on and then he would curl it?
Yes. Yeah. And I think he also... he took the hair on the side, I believe, as far as I remember. It's been a long, long time, 15 years ago. But anyhow, I just remember him doing it that way. And I always ask questions because it's all fascinating to me, you know, hair, makeup, whatever. There's always little cheats you can get away with. And he says, no, this is quite an old-fashioned way, but it just takes a little longer, he said, but it looks way better. And it did. And I mean, it's crazy to me as a performer sometimes. When you sit there, and yeah, sometimes, you know, especially when you have special effects makeup involved, it could take 4 or 5 hours for, you know, the full makeup process. But then you're wearing it and you look at yourself in the mirror. And I mean, there was a few times when, you know, let's say Barney Berman or so on was applying like full on special effects makeup on Grimm as an example. And you go really close in the mirror. And you can't tell that it's not real.
Yeah.
Moves.
And I think it helps actors get into character too.
Oh, totally, totally. But I'm just saying, like, that your kind of work can be so beautifully done. And, you know, especially when you work with pros like you, it's amazing as a performer to wear all that and not being able to actually tell that it's not a real beard, you know, because we all saw some really bad beards too, where it just looks like a mop glued to your face. But
that's one of my pet peeves when people are like, oh, just flap, you know, they're not going to see it. And I'm like, but no, I take pride. I love creating a stunt person so they look so identical to the main actor or actress that when you go on set, you're ready to go touch up one of them and you realize it's the wrong one. And I love seeing the directors getting ready to go talk to them and they're like, oh, it's the wrong person. And I think we all like just kind of chuckle like, all right, this is very, you know, if they get a really close up shot, it's going to really look like the real actor doing the stunt. Mm-hmm. And I think that's what we want.
Yeah, absolutely. That's a really cool point you brought up, because we also do enjoy that, you know, when you stand there and you know you make a real good double and the actor, the director comes up, or the other actors even, hey, do you want to go through some lines? Oh, that's not you. You know, want to rehearse some lines or whatever. Yeah, that's pretty awesome.
Yeah, I always see like the director smile. They're like, all right, this is gonna be good. Right on.
Yeah. What do you love most about your job?
Oh gosh, I think it's bringing the writer and director's vision to life from the script. That's my favorite thing. The creativity, the continuity, it's like putting a jigsaw puzzle together, especially when you shoot out of order. I'm really good with paperwork. But yeah, I like the whole process of filmmaking and TV show making. Mm-hmm. And the creative energy that goes into all of it.
You know, it's crazy to hear people say this, because when people actually know how much you guys do work, especially when you're, you know, like as a stunt performer, you usually come in and you do your day or you do your week, or sometimes you're on the whole run, but you guys are on the set every day and you put in huge hours. Like, I mean, usually at least 12 hours, right?
We're supposed to work less with COVID going on and all the new rules with COVID, with the masks, the shields, the sanitation, okay, even more than ever. But I see that things are taking a little longer. But a lot of times we've worked 15, 16, 17, 18 hours. There's been twice in my career that I've worked 25 hours straight.
Holy cow.
And they were both on movies, and they were both had to do with special effects. And I have to say, like, thank goodness somebody drives you home on a movie set when you're on location. Cause I was like, if I was home, I don't know how I would have gotten home. Cause you go into almost like a different mindset when you're that tired, when you've been up for that long.
Right. What show was that?
One of it was New Daughter. And it was a creature that we did. It didn't play every day, but it would take us 6 hours and three makeup artists. It was with Todd Masters to create the alien or sci-fi character. And then it was a minimum of 3 hours to take it off every single day.
Holy cow.
And this actor was completely covered. He had the black lenses. He had the teeth. He had the long fingernails. Like this, he was completely covered from head to toe with makeup. And you barely, if you watch the movie, you don't even see the character.
Mm.
But it was a lot of makeup. And then we had two doubles to double the main alien character.
So they went through the same process.
They went through the same process. And sometimes we would shoot once a week. Sometimes we would shoot two or three times a week, but we never did it consecutively, so that we gave the actor and the stunt doubles and the photo double time for their skin to breathe, especially when you're completely covered from head to toe.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a pain. You know, people think it's cool, and it is kind of cool to a certain degree, but it's also extremely uncomfortable. I mean, especially those big black lenses that just, was it the big ones that cover the eyeball?
Yeah, have you had to wear those before?
I did, and I hate it's a pain. I mean, I hate regular lenses to begin with. I'm gotten better, but it's not fun to wear, and they start burning and your eyes are getting dry. But then also I had a full suit on several times on different creature shows. And I was a werewolf on some low budget movie with Sig Haig, actually. I know you worked with him as well. But
who is it?
A movie with Sig Haig.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Great guy. But it was a low budget werewolf movie. And me and this other guy were werewolves. And they had a special effects makeup team from Greece, I believe they brought. And we were out in Pahrump, Nevada, tiny, tiny hole in the wall in the desert, just outside of Vegas. And it was foam latex, the whole thing. And so we had boots that glued on to your pants. The pants that glued onto your top, the top that glued onto your gloves, and huge claws. And then it was like a hood, and then they glued on the face. So the whole thing was just wrapped in. So you couldn't eat because you had teeth. You were, you know, sucking on a straw at lunch. And you can't go to the bathroom.
I was going to say, so when they had first designed this creature for New Daughter, they didn't make a hole for the actor to. And so that was a whole production. And then they had to like eventually create something so he could.
Yeah, it's major pain. And then you got to somehow manage that you can take your gloves off too, you know?
He couldn't even eat because he had these long nails. And I was just like, I couldn't believe he would go every single day with like, and especially that one day that we went for 25 hours. But we didn't get to have to go back to work for like 2 days after that. So we all just like slept. So that was nice.
That's crazy. Holy cow. You made some overtime.
Yeah, definitely made some overtime on that one.
You know, a good friend of mine, an actor, Robert is his name, Maillet, he's a Canadian actor, huge guy. He's like 7'1". We worked together on Immortals. He was the bad guy or one of the bad guys on Sherlock Holmes. Sweetheart of a guy, but a giant, right? And he was a creature on 300, and he had a very elaborate special effects makeup on his face that took hours. And they actually asked him to take it home, sleep with it, so they don't have to go through the whole process again the next day. And obviously he was on payroll for, you know, 2.5 days straight, but still he's like, yeah, they asked me to wear this stuff home and go to sleep with it. It's crazy. I never heard of it.
Well, I've never heard of that, but I have heard of wearing tattoos home, especially if it's a full body tattoos and tattoos are everywhere. And let's say we do wrap at 4 a.m. in the morning, and I know they especially don't like to do forced calls with stunts because it's a safety thing, but they'll do forced calls a lot with makeup and hair. And it's easier, especially if it's a 3-hour tattoo job, to wear it. I definitely understand to take it off every night, but there's certain exceptions that it does help if the stunt performer or the actor does wear it home. When we did Sense of Anarchy, a lot of the actors would wear them for a week on end because they didn't want to have to shoot all day and get that reapplied and come in an extra hour and a half early every single day to get those tattoos on. Right. Now, there's swastikas or like demeaning tattoos. You don't want to go home with those. And I would never do that to anyone. But there's sometimes like it's a cool snake tattoo. And it's like if we're wrapping at 4 a.m. in the morning and you got to be back at 8 a.m. there's nothing else to do, just go to bed. It does help out, but I know shows don't normally like to do that, but sometimes it does help. And a good thing if you ever have to do that is to put a bunch of baby powder on the tattoo, because what will happen is you won't stick to the bed sheets, and it'll also keep it fresh and easier for the makeup artist to clean it up the next day. Okay. I just worked with a couple stunts and they went through a window. It's really good to have baby powder as well when you go through a window or glass, because you can get little chars. I'm sure this has happened to you, and little cuts throughout the week. And you're like, where'd that come from? Well, it was from Monday. You went out the glass on the one show. But if you put baby powder all over you, the glass will actually soak up into the baby powder.
No way.
So keep baby powder. I also say keep arnica. I'll give you some stunt tips right now. And especially, I can tell when stunt people are new to doing stunts. And I'll show you with earplugs. So this is arnica. You can put it on bruises. Have you ever used this?
Yeah.
You can also like take the little tablets too, and it's all natural.
Are you kidding me?
Comfortable. As I talk about stunts.
Gosh, you rock. You know, I was just going to say, I'm actually making merchandise now and hats.
Oh, very cool. Right on.
I can't believe you made it before me.
So a lot of times we'll give stunt people earplugs like this. And this is how I know that they're new to stunts. They'll go like this.
Yeah.
And it looks like to me a reindeer. But normally makeup artists will have earplugs. And what we've done is we've cut these in half, and we take a little plastic baggie, and we put the cut earplugs with a little, this is called, this is makeup, but it's alcohol based. and we cover the earplugs, and they actually look like doggy biscuits. And we lay them out and we dry. But the nice thing about this is it looks like the ear hole, because you see a little shadow in the ear hole. Mm-hmm. And how I know is when they just take it from the prop guy, and I'm like, but during the worst thing I can do watching a movie is when I see a stunt person looking like a reindeer. And I was like, oh my gosh, I saw the earplugs like this. But if somebody, if a makeup artist gives you one of these, and always ask for the makeup artist to give them to you. I always, and a lot of times I'm teaching this on set. I'm like, take it and squish it and then put it in the ear. I mean, you'd rather see that than that.
Well, you're right.
And if it gets stuck, that's great, because you're not going to lose your eardrums when the gun goes off, when the fake gun goes off, or the loud crash. Also, there's tweezers, and we can just take them out. They're super easy. Mm-hmm. So that's one of my other tricks. And also, can I just say sunblock and sunscreen, which is really important, because a lot of times I think stunt people think that they're like, oh, I don't need it. But what will happen is if we're outside for 12 hours, and let's say they're there for, you know, right, what I'm going to say. So we're there on Monday, by Friday, they've gone from like, I'm pretty fair, to like really dark. And especially if they're playing like, let's say, an FBI agent or a cop, or they're actually featured and they're not doubling someone, they change colors, and it does throw the continuity off. So if they don't want us to put on it, which we're really happy to put sunscreen on people, they can put it on themselves. There's powders, there's lotions, there's gels, there's something for everyone out there. And being an esthetician is really important too, so that you don't get skin cancer or melanoma.
Yeah. No, I'm totally that guy too. Like, you know, and I remember several times you asking me, hey, do you want some sunscreen? He's like, no, I'm okay. I'm good. And you know, in the beginning, you're kind of fair. And at the end of the week, you look like a surfer, right? You just.
Yeah, exactly. And then if they have to reshoot something, it's like, that guy doesn't even look like. That surfer doesn't even like, or the guy in the tank top who is like walking along the beach, he doesn't even look like the guy from, so.
Yeah.
And I'm always looking at that. When I watch TV shows and movies, I'm always looking at the continuity, and it'll literally throw me off if I see things like that.
You know, my daughter Geneva, she's like that too. She's so good. Like, she's like, the hair was the other way, or he held the cup in that hand, or this and that. I don't know. She just has an eye for it. It's funny. It's crazy. But I remember actually on The Rookie, I think it was you telling me that Nathan kept looking over and thinking, it's like, I think he's looking at you because you got darker, you got more tan. I do tan really quickly, and I don't wear sunscreen, and it's a bad thing, I know.
Come up and we'll get you sunscreen. We'll get you sunscreen you like.
It's not that I don't like it, you know, I don't know. I just figured, I don't need it. I don't burn that easy. I guess that's my thought process, you know, which is wrong.
Yeah. Well, especially if you're doubling someone, you want to stay the same color as the person you're doubling. Otherwise, then lots of makeup gets involved, and nobody wants to put makeup everywhere. Usually the actors sweat it off, and it's waterproof, and then you have to come in at the end of the night. And I know stunt people do not like coming in at the end of the night to get cleaned up. Mm. And that's another thing. If you have a beard or mustache, please, or wig, do not rip it off. I don't think some people realize those are worth hundreds and thousands of dollars.
Right. Yeah, absolutely.
No. Those are my tips.
What was one of your biggest challenges in general, not just at work? Let's just look back at your life. What was one of the biggest challenges you had to overcome, and how did you do it?
I think I'm still working on that. I can take things too personally. And it's something that I am working on right now. I did a big pilot, and I ran into the producer a couple years later, and he's like, why didn't you do the series? And I told him, I said, I felt like I wasn't wanted there. And I'm used to going to shows where I really feel wanted. And I took it personally, and he's like, you need to get over that. And I'm like, I do need to go over that, but that's the way I felt. So yeah, I'm always trying to work on myself. What do they say? Like, half of our jobs is what we do on set. For me, half of it is makeup. the other half is either personality or I used to when I was younger, and I still can do it. I put my foot in my mouth, and so if I ever do that, tell me, like, Michelle, you probably shouldn't have said that. Because sometimes I've been very honest, sometimes too honest, and I'll just say it out loud, and I realize that maybe I should have just waited.
But you know what? I think that's why you and I got along quickly. We're both the same way that way.
Like, well, yeah, also because you sat down at the station with my Switzerland mug.
Yeah.
I was like, okay, we were meant to be friends.
Yeah, you know what? It's funny. Why do you think that we do take things too personally? I'm the same way. There's situations when I'm looking back at I could probably just say it. You know, I worked on a movie. I'm not gonna get too personal, but I worked on one movie that then had, I think, one or two more. It was a series, and the coordinator hired me. We were friends prior. I got to work on the first one, but then not on the second and not on the third. And I literally beat myself up over it for months trying to figure out what I did wrong. Right. Where I mean, I don't want to
say sometimes we don't do anything wrong. It just, right. Sometimes it's like we don't click, or maybe they don't click, or there was different reasons, like maybe nepotism, maybe not nepotism, maybe something happen where and a lot of times we don't know, and we never find out, or we do find out, and we're like, oh, and it's like, why did I take it so personally? And yeah. I think it's also because we care, and I think that's the whole thing. I mean, we get to do this awesome job and make film and television shows all day, and I mean, we're living the dream. Mm-hmm. And there are some people on set that don't care. And there's others that, like, we really care. And I think that's why sometimes we'll take it personally. Mm-hmm.
And what do you think is a remedy to overcome that?
I'm still figuring that out. I try to be thankful and meditate and try to have a positive attitude. I try to smile and to be present. And sometimes I will take on too many jobs at the same time. And sometimes I say yes to places that maybe I'm not the perfect fit. So I've been learning, like when I was younger, I would always try to put myself, like, what do they say? The square in the round hole, like the peg in the round hole. And I would force it, and nobody had a good time. And I realized, like, I can't do that anymore. Like when people want you there, they want you there, and there's for a reason. And that's where you want to be. You want to be surrounded by people that want you there, and you want to be there too. So sometimes I think we start searching when we don't really need to search. It's there all along.
Wow, that's good. That's beautiful. What would you tell the 20-year-old Michelle if you could go back in time?
Oh, wow. Keep your mouth quiet. Wow. I feel like I have made mistakes before, and you can just learn from them. Absolutely. And go with your gut, because there's been a couple times I didn't go with my gut when I knew I should have. And when I go with my gut, it's like I have the greatest time normally. I mean, and yeah, listen to your thoughts. It's not always about money. It's not, I find that I have the best time when I'm working with my friends and passion projects, and where I get to create. Because sometimes you can make a lot of money, but you're not happy.
Yeah, 100%. I remember, I forgot who I talked to about that exact point, because I remember having a lot of fun on very low budget movies, you know, where there was one, that's crazy. So I was 26 years old. I just got here a couple of years prior. And I don't know if you know Terry James.
No.
Yeah, good friend of mine. He's been around for decades. doubled David Hasselhoff and so on. Just a good, solid dude. Very, very versatile and stunt coordinator, stuntman, second director. But we worked together on a soap opera called Passions.
Oh, yeah. And wait, was that at NBC?
CBS.
CBS, that's right. In Los Angeles, right?
Yeah, on Radford. Okay. But it was him and a few others, and we worked a long day until we walked back to the parking structure together, and we chatted all day. We just clicked, right? And my English was really poor so back then. And he said, hey, you know, I'm producing this low-budget horror movie. It's really low budget, but it's going to be a lot of fun, lots of action. Do you want to coordinate it? And I'm like, yeah, that'd be fantastic, right? But also, I drove the main bad guy truck, which was a 77 Suburban. I did all kind of stunts. I did a full fire burn. The flames were about 14 feet high, full fire burn at night, getting hit by a 77 Suburban. And I got $100, but I had a blast. You know what I mean? Like, I don't care. It's just, it's in here. It's a passion. Not to say that you should never make money, but it's not always the most important factor. And you shouldn't be driven by money. You know, I believe it should be just your passion, and you follow it, you do a good job, you stay with it, and money will come.
Exactly. I believe that too. Absolutely.
And you gotta give, you gotta help out, you gotta give back. You know, so many people in my industry, in my career, helped me in so many different ways. And so then it's always important to give back, not when you, once you got there, but constantly, right? Like, no matter what level you're at, it's always important to help someone out achieving their goals, and mentoring, and yeah, just be a good guy or a good lady and help out, right? So karma, I guess it's called, right?
I had, when I first started working in Los Angeles, I didn't have a place to stay. I was either in Santa Barbara, tried to make it here as an artist. I was 21, and I just wasn't getting enough jobs. So I moved in with my mom in Arizona for a year and a half, and then I started working. I was like this little minnow in this huge ocean. I wouldn't get any jobs in Los Angeles, or very far and few between, definitely not to pay my rent or my bills. And then when I moved to Arizona, because I was from LA, from California, I was a bigger fish in this small pond, and I was able to meet people. And that's when I did Three Kings, and I got to work on Tin Cup and a couple other really cool projects. And I remember I met people, and then I came back and... One of my girlfriends before I had a place, Claudia Christian, she was on Babylon 5. She would always allow me to stay there. And so to this day, I like to always have a guest room wherever I live, because I want to give back to people, because people help me. And I want to help people because not all of us live here, and we come back and forth. So I totally believe in karma and giving back.
And you offered that guest room to me several times.
I did.
We'll take you up on it, because I don't have a place in LA anymore. You know, I usually stay with my buddy John Moyo in Woodland Hills, but yeah, I'll come down and hang out with you guys.
That'd be right awesome. On.
So thanks for doing that. What are some of the proudest moments that you have?
I think definitely being nominated for an Emmy, and winning a Makeup Artist and Hairstylist Guild Award. I also get proud when a makeup comes together. I was doing stunt doubles, and one of the girls, they were in a tank top, she had a completely full sleeve, and like even like just airbrushing the makeup so that she looked just like the actress. Like whenever a makeup comes out good, like I get happy. So it doesn't take a lot, really. And I still get butterflies when I get called to work and during interviews, and yeah, the whole process makes me happy. And when everything, like if I'm doing a special effects and maybe I haven't done it before, when I worked on Major Crimes, that was a really great show to work on. They always let me do things that I hadn't done before. And you're not always given that opportunity, but they always encouraged me to learn. And I think that's why it's my favorite show I've ever worked on, because they believed in me. And I didn't always have, like one time I was doing a Y incision, which is like when they cut a person down. It was in the morgue, and I over painted it. They get in front of the camera and the whole makeup cracked. And the camera guys came up to me and they're like, Michelle, it cracked. We're going to help you. We're going to help you out. We're going to like light it. And we're just going to do like bits and pieces. And I knew the director saw it. I knew my boss had seen it, but they're like, you learned. What'd you learn? I'm like, I overpainted, not to overpaint again. So, but I was happy that I had done it, but then, you know, sometimes it doesn't always work out, but you have to keep on going. Mm-hmm. And especially with TV, you don't have time to redo it.
Right.
TV has always, I'm a perfectionist and I'm OCD, and they give you little time and you have to do the best work in the time that they give you.
Mm-hmm. How did you learn special effects makeup?
I took some private courses, and then on set, if I wasn't doing anything else, I would go watch the special effects artists, and I would take classes. A lot of times our unions will give like weekend classes. I would sign up for everything. I didn't care if I was working Monday through Friday. I didn't care if I wrapped at 5 a.m. in the morning and there was a union class going on from 9 to 5 Saturday and Sunday, and I had to be back at work on, let's say, Monday at 4 a.m. I didn't care. I was like, I'm going to learn this. I'm going to be the best artist I can be.
Wow.
And I'm still like, in 2 weeks from now, I'm going to take another class. So I love learning. And there's always something new. There's always new technology. And you learn from everybody. I learn from everybody on set.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. And it's fun. I think it's interesting because everybody's job comes with interesting aspects, even the grip guys or, you know, whatever. Like I love talking to everybody and asking them questions regarding their equipment. And even I talked to Eric, our grip guy on The Rookie, right? He's been around for a long time and he's probably mid 50s or so. And I'm always interested in the history of everything. Where does that come from? Why are they called grips, you know, or best boy? There's all the amazing stories or histories about all this stuff. And same makeup, you know. You know Barney, right? Barney Berman?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I brought him into a commercial a couple of years ago, and I think that they never even – he spent weeks on, and it was this great makeup. He made Moses, and it was a lot of special effects. And I think it got shelved. They didn't even like show the commercial. Mm. But so anyway, that's always disappointing. Like when you work on something and then it's never shown.
Yeah, totally. But, you know, I worked with him a lot, and to get all the stories from his dad and his grandpa, you know, being in the same profession, it's just fascinating. And talking about different materials that were used back in the day, and you know, spirit gum has been around for so long. And I just had this conversation, I forgot with who, but before COVID hit, I was at work and we were talking about silicone appliances versus foam latex and so on. And you know, so many new glues have come out for the silicone appliances.
Oh yeah.
Then I was saying, yeah, so spirit gum is pretty much done, right? And he says, nope, there's still great places for it. You know, although it's kind of a pain in the butt to get, you know, clean off and so on. But some people just, some old things just still work, you know?
Oh, absolutely. I was using this. So the other day, I needed to cover a tattoo and I wasn't expecting it. And I had a tattoo palette, but it didn't have like all the skin tone colors. It had the primary colors, which were three. And I was like, okay, I'm going to go back to old school. I'm going to learn how to mix paint right now. And I'm going to cover that tattoo. And I did, because I was on location. It's the only thing I had. So I was like, I'm going to do this. So yep. A lot of times we just have to go back to our roots and go, how did we do that? How did we learn that? Absolutely.
You had three colors?
Yeah, I had three colors, and I think white and black. And then I saw the tattoo. And that's another thing. When stunt people come in, let us know if you have tattoos. There's so many licensings and laws with the tattoos and the tattoo artist that it's better to tell us up front than once we're on set and we start shooting.
You know, so I'm going to throw this at you since you brought that up. There's a bit of some stunt guys or stunt girls that have a lot of tattoos, they don't mention that because they're afraid of the makeup department saying we don't have the time, and then they lose the job. That's one of the reasons I found out is why a lot of stunt performers don't mention that they have tattoos, which is not cool because you guys need time to do that, obviously, but they're afraid of losing work because they feel that makeup department has so much say. You know, when the stunt coordinator has to bring in a few ND people, as an example, and back guys or back girls or whatever, and he shows the director a bunch of headshots. The director picks from the headshots. And now if the knowledge would be there that that person has a lot of tattoos, they're worried about losing the job. Is that the case, you think?
I have heard that. I really think if they're the same height, the same body, they have the same color of skin, sometimes it makes sense to hire the person with the tattoos. And then, you know, as makeup artists, that's what we do. We cover tattoos.
Yeah.
So I have heard that, but never be, it's better to say it up front than to find out while they're ready to say action. And there's 200 people on set, five cameras going on, because if they get a close up of that with one of the cameras, they can't use that shot. Mm-hmm. And let's say it's a very special shot.
Right.
And I always say, don't get any more. Did you get any more?
Well, you saw this one. That's my last one I got.
Wait, did you add on to that?
No.
Oh, how cute. No, I haven't seen that one.
You haven't? No, it's Geneva.
Wait, when'd you get that one? I guess I haven't covered your tattoos in a while.
Yeah, Christy usually does it. I got that, I believe, in June. Yeah.
And then you have one on the other, right?
Up here, yeah. Not very proud about it. Now, if I could go back and tell the 20-year-old Oliver, he's like, don't do that. Anyhow, you're so joyful. You have such a great laugh. And you know, from the moment that I met you, you bring light to a room and to an environment. So you definitely have a great personality. And I think there's no shortage on work coming towards you.
Thanks. You're making me blush.
How do you keep you married for how long now?
14 years.
14 years. How do you keep excitement in your work and marriage?
Well, sometimes I don't know how exciting I am. I'm definitely the wild one in the marriage, but I'm always working. So I think that's one thing. It's been really tough with my husband with COVID. He hasn't been on set since you saw him at the airport in Atlanta when he was coming back from the movie. So it's been tough for him. And I've been busy. I'm like, come paint with me. But he does. He cooks, which has been really nice. And like once or twice a week. I think it's definitely when I've been working too much, like running the business, being on set. I also have international clients that send me products, and I do reports on their products. So sometimes I work 7 days a week. I think it's really important to take time out, and even if it's to go away for the weekend to Palm Springs or Santa Barbara, but just take time for each other.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. I kind of can imagine it's going to be rough when, you know, because he works a lot too, usually, and you do, you know, it's going to be hard on a marriage when there is those periods of times where you don't see each other much, right?
He just started doing movies in the last couple of years since we've been married. We had, in the beginning, we said that we weren't going to go on location, but it's also a nice break, because then when you haven't seen each other for a while, then you're like, okay, cool. I get to see you now. Where, I mean, he was home every single day for 6 months, and sometimes it's good to have the space. I think it's healthy to have space sometimes.
I agree with you. What made you want to create your own skincare line? How did that come up?
Well, 16 years ago, I was working on a sitcom. It was called Complete Savages, and it was actually Mel Gibson's sitcom that nobody even knows about. I don't even think anyone watched it, but I had so much fun on the sitcom. But as a sitcom, as a makeup artist, you only shoot 6 days out of the whole entire month. I was always an esthetician, and I actually went to college to be a nurse, but I never became a nurse. So I started working at Kaiser Permanente, and I was in charge of all the estheticians, and I would do that 3 days a week in plastic surgery and dermatology for Southern California. And part of our thing was doing chemical peels, meeting with people, everything from people who had been burned to anti-aging to acne. And I wanted products to help everyone. And that's when I created Vivid MD Skincare. And Vivid means clear and bright, and MD because it was focused on the medical field, medical dermatological skincare. So it's much stronger than over-the-counter, so a little goes a long way.
Oh, wow. Really? Okay. So this here, Geneva and I looked at the Purifying Whipped Cleanser.
Yes.
Tell us about that.
That's 2-in-1. So it's basically Scott Foley. He calls it the fancy thick Noxzema. So if anyone knows what Noxzema, this is a little thicker. It's, you want to take a little bit out, and if you open it up, it's very thick, and you want to mix it with water in the palm of your hand, and it'll actually start foaming. But you can also shave with it. So when you shave with it, you want to use a little bit more. But it'll actually stop pseudoflocculitis, which is ingrown hair on guys. A lot of times their beard will actually start curling in, and that's called pseudoflocculitis. When that happens, then they get a pimple, and then they have to usually pull it out, and then the sun will hit it, and then they can turn into a scar. So it's all natural. You can smell it. It smells like cloves. Mm-hmm. But it's the 2-in-1, and guys like it. You know, it's funny. My products have been sold in castles in Palma de Mallorca, which I even got to go there one time, which was super cool. And that's like right off of Spain. It's sold in health food store in Canada, and it's had a very interesting life of itself. Before, it was supposed to be just for medical use, and now it's kind of taken on its own life. Now, online sales have been really well. People don't want to go into stores anymore and pick things up, especially with COVID.
Yeah.
And they like to buy from a small company. And they know that if I get sick, then everyone's going to know that I'm sick. So they also know that it's from a trusted source.
Okay. Good point. Tell us about the Morocco castle visit. What happened there?
A makeup artist who was also a massage therapist and an esthetician, she worked at a castle, and she started ordering this product. So every time first of all, I didn't know that was an island. And I don't even know if I'm saying it right. I didn't know it was an island until I got to go there. But I would take a box that was maybe like this big, and it would be $100 to ship. And I was like, why is it so expensive to like, you know, even France and Spain is cheaper than this place. And then when I finally got to go there, I realized, like, oh my gosh, it's a castle. And it's some of the richest people in the world. It's like Monaco. And at the same time that I went there, I got to go to Monaco. And like everybody's driving Ferraris and Lamborghinis. And I'm like, this place is like, it has so much money. Like, wow. And yeah, they would use it in this castle. And it was an amazing experience that I got to do that. Like one of my first clients that ever bought my product was Priscilla Presley. And so she wrote me a check and I kept the check the longest time and I would not cash it. And then I finally like took a, it was before you could do it on your phone and everything else, but I never wanted to cash it, but I eventually had to cash it. Because when you're starting a business, you have to put the money back into it.
Right.
And then I also got to do the Meghan Markle. It's had a very fascinating celebrity following, which has been really cool. And people don't realize, like, I see everything that goes on being a small business. So I see every time someone orders and I see the name and I get really excited. And what do they say with a small business? Every time you have a sale, there's like, there's elves dancing and happiness. And it's true because, and especially now, I see so many things around me. I love to spin, and I've been spinning on the ocean. It's been great. We're close to Redondo Beach, and there's all these bikes on the ocean, and everything's social distancing. But it's one of the only gyms I know that's open, but it's an outdoor gym. And I think it's just really important because so many of the places around where we're living is closing down. Like I had this one spin package to this one place that I love going, and they're like, oh, we're not in business anymore. And some of our favorite restaurants, Cafe Del Rey, which has been there for 20 years, that closed down. I was like, oh man. So I can't wait for them to be a vaccine. And it makes me sad every time I see, and when Santa Monica, they really trashed the place during the looting. Hmm. And I feel sorry for the people that have small businesses because it's not cool.
Mm. No, it's horrible.
How's it in Atlanta? Did you guys have looting or anything like that?
Oh yeah. Yeah. I mean, the city was on fire, right? I mean, we're lucky because this place is a small community. The population is only about 30,000 and we're about 40 minutes south of Atlanta. Yeah, but 30 minutes north is where that Wendy's was burned down again. And you know what? Look, I understand the whole thing, right? Black lives, of course, matter. Absolutely. But why go down, burn down businesses that are...
And it's not even the people that are doing the cause. It's people that have used those people. And yeah, the whole thing is sad. And the police, like, we need police. I don't know what's going on in Portland right now, but they're not doing very well.
Mm, no. No.
And I'm very interested to see because I love watching The Rookie. I feel like every episode tells a story and there's also a moral behind it. Like, I always like to watch it. And I like pick up on a moral. I'm like, oh, this is what I learned for this episode. And I'm really wondering what they're going to write for next season. Yeah. Are they going to write about protesting? Are they going to, I mean, and then a couple seasons ago, remember we did like the whole, it was that weird flu and it was a weird virus. And so I was like, oh my gosh, they were ahead of their time.
Ooh, right.
Yeah.
Yeah. I forgot about that.
So I'm wondering how they're going to, like, write all that. And the defunding, like, come on, we need police. I mean, I can't imagine the world without police. We need them.
No, absolutely. There's so many strange things happening. You know, like, I heard in California they released another 18,000 prisoners, right?
Whew.
How does that make sense, right? Like, you know what? I saw this meme the other day. It says, you know, if masks work, why don't you just give the prisoners masks?
That's a really good point, actually. How many prisons have you shot in?
Oh, shit. You know, a lot of them. The worst, though, was in Puerto Rico, and it was an old prison from the 20s. and it was a what's it called, juvenile prison, and Michelle, it was the creepiest place, one of the creepiest places I've ever worked on. First of all, production had to go in 2 weeks prior because that whole prison was not active anymore, of course, but it was full of squatters, right? So there was feces and all kind of filth. So the crew went in there 2 weeks prior and cleaned everything out. They kind of moved all the squatters in this one wing way down, and we shot in this big area. But although the floor looked kind of clean, it was still filthy, you know? And so we shot in there for 2 or 3 days, big shootout sequence. I was doubling Joe Manganiello, and it was just a really eerie place. And I remember something very creepy. In one area, I found like old handcuffs, like shackles, you know, 80 some years old. And they were twisted. They were twisted and just bent. And I don't know if you ever held real handcuffs. They're super, super heavy duty steel, right? And the crazy part about it was I looked for any kind of marks of pliers or whatever that could do this kind of shape, but there was nothing on there. It was smooth.
That is a haunted place.
Really, almost like totally, totally demon possessed, ghost, creepy place.
The one that freaks me out every time I have to shoot there, I would almost rather shoot in real prisons, which I've done. But it's the women's one that's closed, Sybil. Right? Like that place freaks me out. I cannot go down the halls by myself without getting freaked out. Like there are some ghosts there.
Yeah, I've never been in there.
Watch, that'll be your next one.
Yeah, it's definitely creepy. And, you know, oh man, that's a whole different conversation, different podcast platform, really, to go down that rabbit hole. But you have to come up with a different shirt then.
Or we could talk about our favorite places that we filmed.
Yeah.
I really want to go to Europe. I really want to go to Italy. That's my dream job, is to go to Italy and work on a movie or a TV show. I got to go to Lake Como last year and do a wedding, which was really cool. But I really want to work in Europe, and I want to go to Sweden. Have you been to Sweden?
I haven't been to Sweden. I haven't been to any of those northern countries. I haven't been to...
What? No. That doesn't even make sense.
Weird. So I lived in Switzerland for 24 years, and believe it or not, over there, because it's such a small country, right, it takes you 3 hours to drive from one side to the other. Driving for an hour is something that needs to be talked about. It's like, do we really want to drive an hour? It's kind of far, you know. And then living in the States for 20 years, where I've driven across the country several times now, it takes you all day to go through Texas, right? And so it's a different perspective. So then now when I went back to Switzerland for different shows or just family visits the last few years, you know, it would be no problem to drive down to Saint-Tropez from Zurich, to 10-hour drive.
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah, or Lake Como, you know, it's like 5 hours from Lake Como. I remember actually Geneva was like a year and a half, 2 years old, and we got to Lake Como. We spent a day, went shopping, and then and that evening I was looking at the map, and I was saying, hey, you know what? In 4 hours we could be in Venice, right? So the next day we drove to Venice, and it just cruised around. And so when you're there, when you live there, then you don't think that way, right? Because you're in this small life, kind of, this small country. So I think living in the States for a while gave me that bigger, broader aspect. And it's like, hey, you know what, it's really not that big a deal to go there, you know. Yeah, let's drive to Arizona or whatsoever, and you can get around Europe quickly. So yeah, I hope you get a job there. I got one coming in Switzerland that we're not going to shoot till spring 22. We're going to do testing in 21 in spring. It's a really cool story, and based on a true story that plays in the 60s. I don't know. Maybe we can talk to my director friend. I just talked to him last night. We're going to have Willy Steiger. Do you know that name?
That's not familiar, yeah.
Yeah, he's a Swiss guy that moved to the States, 30 some years ago. and he became one of the top DPs. I think he did Austin Powers, Godzilla, just big, big movies. So he lives in Hollywood, and he's going to come out and be the DP on that. And there's a sound guy, also a Swiss dude, that worked in the States for decades. I don't know. Well, maybe you can be a part of it. We'll figure it out.
Isn't it cool when you get to go home and film? You're like, wow, this is cool. I remember I got to film a movie in San Francisco, and we were like around Haight Street. And I was like, I'm actually filming like around where I grew up. And it's like the coolest thing, because it's like, I never imagined when I was an adult, I would come back here and I get to work.
Yeah, no, you're absolutely right. What's an advice that you would give someone that feels that is kind of stuck in their world, where they're not happy with their job and they've been doing maybe the same thing, or they jump from job to job, but they really have a passion, maybe they have even a big talent for something. What kind of advice would you give someone like that?
I would say don't have fear. I know that's really hard, but a lot of times, I remember when I really wanted to do makeup. And when I got into the guild, into the union 706, I was doing, a lot of times I would have to do makeup and hair at the same time, but I was never really into hair. So the moment I got into the union, I gave away all my hair stuff so that I could really concentrate. So you can't have the fear. You just got to kind of put that aside and just go for it. Like recently I sent somebody, like my makeup idol, my reel and my resume. And then I found out later through another makeup artist, he's like, you really shouldn't have sent your reel because you have iPhone photos. And then I'm like, oh, you're not supposed to have iPhone. Like, I didn't know. And I was like, you know something? I'm not going to go to my grave knowing that I didn't give him my resume or my reel. So it's, sometimes you just have to like go and do it. Don't be scared. And I mean, you don't want to wake up 10, 20 years from now and say, like, I regret that I didn't try to do that.
God, yeah. That is just something that, I mean, that's the answer right there, I think, because, you know, you only got one life and it goes by too quick, as we see. And I know several people that are now in their 70s, and I know their life pattern. And I know that they're thinking, man, I wish I did, right? And one of them even told me. And that just breaks my heart. You know, because yeah, you're going to fail, you know, and there's that fear. But I mean, how high can you really fall? You know what I mean? And if you fail, and just do it again.
Just get back up on the horse. What do they say? When you fall, just get back up on the horse. I think I've made some more mistakes than other people. And I'm like, you know, you just got to keep on getting up. Like sometimes you don't want to, but you'll be happy that you did get back up.
And you know what? Here's the thing too. You made a good point just now. Well, mistakes is a good thing because you learn out of them.
Absolutely.
You know, people
are tougher than others, but yeah, you absolutely do. Yeah. You definitely learn from all of them.
You know,
people, and I think it's really important to be present and be aware and try to learn those things. It'll just make you better in the long run. And especially what we do for a living, it's not just one person. It takes a team to do everything.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think life is like that. You know, life is a team effort because you always need someone that helps you up, and you always need someone to mentor you. Like you and I talked on the phone last night. So we're going to, you know, I'm still learning to technical aspect of all this stuff, right? I had to learn how to build a website. I had to learn how to use Zoom and record it and all that stuff, and then edit those videos and so on. And it's fun, but it took time. But I do want to connect more with everyone, and I'm going to do some research and learn how to do live YouTube videos. So that could be fun for people to tune in and just reconnect, you know, and then pick each other's brains, or have maybe there, you know, I'm sure there's tons of people out there that would love to get into the field of makeup and maybe even hair. And I'm sure it can be of a lot of guidance for them. So we'll line that up for sure.
I'd love that. That sounds great.
Hey, so where can people find your product?
You can go to vividmdskincare.com. There's several places that carry makeup artists that are makeup supplies and skincare supplies and hair supplies that we use a lot on films. Friends, Nigel's, Namie's, they also carry it. But most people do online ordering these days. vividmdskincare.com. And when you order, you can put in the code Instagram in capital letters and you can get 20% off.
Oh, fantastic. And, so how did I find you on Instagram? What's your name there?
It's vividmdskincare is the skincare. And then my personal one is that Michelle Garbin. And it's only because Michelle Garbin was taken. So I just put the in front of Michelle Garbin.
Okay. I'm going to put it right here. You should see
right there.
Well, Michelle, it was really cool to talk to you and see you. And thanks for making that shirt. That's really
of course. Yay. I can't wait to see your merchandise.
Yes. Yes. I'm going to send you some things then. Send me.
Yay. Right on. And you speak German, right? How many languages do you speak?
I speak Swiss German and proper German, and I'm learning Spanish right now.
Very cool.
What about you?
I'm learning Italian.
Oh, cool.
Because I came to Citizen a couple of years ago through my husband, who was born in Italy, even though he was raised in Los Angeles. So I've been doing a lot of Zooming with Italian, and so that's been fun. And English and sign language. Just a little bit of Spanish.
Okay. What do you use to learn Italian?
The Italian Cultural Institute in Westwood, they used to have classes that you could go on. And it's a great little place once past COVID. When the world opens up again, it's a great little museum. They used to have classes in classroom upstairs from the museum. There's also a theater there. It's where my husband and I actually got married. But now they do everything in Zoom. But it used to be 10-week classes when you used to go to the place, but now, and it's anywhere from 2 to 4 hours and you get to pick what level you want. They have everything from beginning to conversation to like level 10. Right now I'm in level 4. So I'm slowly learning. I still don't have the accent down, but maybe you can tell. Like I remember when I had to touch up your cover your tattoo, and everyone's like, "What, you're from Switzerland?" Like nobody even knew that you were from Switzerland because you have no accent.
Well, I got really tired of every conversation starting with "Where you're from."
So I can see that. So I need to work on my accent a little bit more. So I guess it makes practice, right? Like everything we do, we need to practice.
Yep. I use Duolingo. That works really good. And
Yeah, I've been doing that too. I like that a lot.
Yeah. Geneva is learning proper German right now too, because it's a different language. You know, proper German is where Austrian and Swiss German all comes from. But anyhow, I can't wait to see you. And we'll definitely take you up on your guest room when I'm in town.
That's right.
Thank you, Michelle.
I'll get you to go spin on the beach with me.
All right, I'll try that. Sounds good. Thank you so much for being here.
Thanks for having me.
Absolutely. Have a good one.
You too.